loshkata hembro loshkadis kilio kosambara lembre badoyo koshkendire vesubrabiyala boshe. Oh, we worship you, Lord. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for tonight. Thank you for what you're about to do. Thank you, Lord, because of who you are. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for strength. Thank you for insight. Thank you for your utterance. Thank you for wisdom and understanding. We pray, Spirit of the living God, you help us tonight so that our lives will never be the same. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Holy Spirit, glorify yourself tonight. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We want to thank God for tonight. Amen. God richly bless you for joining us. We really appreciate you. Please get connected. Tell your loved ones, your friends, family members that we are on live. And you can also link your church or your Bible study group to get through God's word tonight. Hallelujah. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Tonight, we have some serious business to do with. Praise God. We have some serious, very, very serious business to deal with. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. And I want you to brace yourself for what you're about to receive. How I pray that God will teach us and open our eyes to behold wondrous things out of his word. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're going to be looking at a topic titled, The Examples of Jesus' Ministry. The Examples of Jesus' Ministry. Praise God. Or you may title it, The Examples of the Ministry of Jesus. Praise God. The Examples of the Ministry of Jesus, or The Examples of Jesus' Ministry. Praise God. Hallelujah. Let's quickly look at God's word. Let's look at 1 Peter chapter 2, verse number 21. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse number 21. It says, "For even hereto were ye called," praise God, "because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that we should follow his steps. For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that we should follow his steps." Now, when we're talking about the examples of Christ's ministry, I believe a lot of things will be running into your hearts and your minds. And I know what it is like. Because you may be thinking about your personal ministry. I'm not just talking about a church ministry. I'm also talking about your personal life as a ministry. I'm talking about your calling as a ministry. I'm talking about your marriage as a ministry. I'm talking about that institution that you attend as a ministry. I'm talking about your places of work as a ministry. I'm talking about your personal lifestyle, your character as a ministry. Ministry in every area, shape, or form. Praise God. So I want you to elasticate your mind tonight and look at it from a wide scope. Praise God. So when we talk about the ministry tonight, we're not just going to limit it to the calling of a church or a pastor or apostle, a prophet, an evangelist, a teacher. No, no, no. Because some of you might want to excuse yourself to say, well, I am not in any of those ministries, or God didn't call me in that area. Well, for me, it's the ministry of service, or it is the ministry of evangelism and all of these things. A ministry is a ministry, whether it is personal, whether it is a gifting, whether it is a calling, whether it has to do with character. Every single area of your life speaks volume to the glory of God. Praise God. Hallelujah. So the Bible says, Jesus, being an example, he had given us an example that we ought to follow his steps. Follow his steps. Follow his steps. So we are not here tonight to follow the steps of a pastor. We're not here tonight to follow the step of an apostle somehow. We're not here to follow the step of your church standard. We're not here tonight. I'm not going to be teaching about following the steps of a culture or a church tradition or a belief system, but we ought to follow the steps of Jesus. When the Bible talks about following the steps of Jesus, we're not also talking about his footsteps. Yes, that can be an issue, but we're talking about his character. We're talking about the way he do ministry, praise God, or he did while he was on earth, praise God, his relationship with others, hallelujah, even unto the cross, hallelujah, praise God, amen. I also believe that when we talk about ministry, a lot of people will say, Pastor, count me out. I've already failed. Others may say, Pastor, if you know what I went through, if you know the difficult times, the constraints, the challenging experience that I have, I don't want to get into that anymore. Or, Pastor, I was disappointed by my leaders, or being disappointed by the members, or by people. Others may say, well, Pastor, you know, I don't want to even get into that because it seems as if it's a lot of work. It's a lot of burden, a responsibility. I don't want to get involved. Others may say, well, it sounds very scary. It looks so fearful because others, whatever they are saying about ministry or life or responsibility, I don't want to get into it because I don't want to have a headache. Others may have already gotten into it, but they've already given up because of the challenges and the constraints. Others are about to get into it, and there are those who are getting out of it, praise God. But tonight, I want us to pay attention to the will and the plan and the purpose of God for our lives, praise God. So as we've seen, the Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 2, 21, that Jesus is an example. So we're going to be looking at the example of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, tonight. And so please go with me to the book of Luke chapter 23. Luke 23, and I'll be reading from verse 32 to 48. Luke 23, don't forget, is a Bible study tonight. And so let's be prepared for the deep insight from God's word. Luke 23, 32 down to 48. Praise God. I read. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And there were also two other male factors led with him to be put to death. And when they were come to the place which is called Calvary, there they crucified him. And the male factor, one on the right hand and the other on the left. Then said Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And they parted his raiment and cast lots. 35. It says, and the people stood beholding. You can imagine this. They stood there, watching, looking at what was going on, beholding, and the rulers also with them dared him, saying, he saved others, let him save himself, if he be Christ, the chosen of God. 36. And the soldiers also mocked him, coming to him and offering him vinegar, and saying, if thou be the king of the Jews, save thyself. Praise God. Save thyself. Don't forget, we see this word, save, save, save. He saved others, let him save himself. Praise God. And they mocked him that he should save himself. Praise God. 37, this is going to be interesting tonight. Hallelujah. And saying, if thou be the king of the Jews, save thyself. Verse 38. And a superscription also was written over him in letters of Greek and Latin and Hebrew. This is the king of the Jews. Praise God. 39. Hallelujah. And one of the malefactors which were hanged railed on him, saying, if thou be, take note of this now, If thou be Christ, save thyself. For the third time we're hearing this word. Save thyself and us. Praise God. Verse 40. But the other answering, rebuking him, saying, Does not thou fear God, seeing thou art in the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds. But this man, I love this guy. But this man had done nothing amiss. Praise God. And he said unto Jesus, Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. Praise God. And Jesus said unto him, verily I say unto thee, today shall thou be with me in paradise. Praise God. And it was about the sixth hour, and there was a darkness over all the earth until the ninth hour, and the sun was darkened, and the veil of the temple was rent in the midst. Praise God. 46. And when Jesus had cried with a loud voice, he said, Father, into thy hand I commend my spirit. And having said thirst, he gave up the ghost. 47. Now, when the centurion saw that he saw what was done, he glorified God. Wow. Saying, certainly, this was a righteous man. This was a righteous man. Jesus was vindicated twice. One of the other thing that was on the right side said, this man didn't do anything amiss. Praise God. He didn't miss the mark. He did nothing amiss. And here we see the centurion is saying that certainly this was a righteous man. Wow. Verse 48. And all the people that came together to that sight, beholding the things which were done, smote their breast and returned. And all his acquaintance and the women that followed him from Galilee stood afar off, beholding these things. Praise the name of our God. Now, if you looked at this account carefully and you looked at the few verses we've just read from verse 32 down to verse 49, you'll see that this verse is very, very sophisticated, and it's sort of like compressed with a lot of deep revelations that we cannot exhaust the truth from these verses. We are only going to summarize and tap in a little bit as to what God will assist us with tonight. Praise God. Now, I want us to look at several issues in this particular account. The very first thing we're going to be looking at is the purpose of Christ's ministry. Secondly, we're going to be looking at the fulfillment of Christ's ministry. And then thirdly, we're going to be looking at Christ's focus and determination. Praise God. And then finally, we'll be looking at ourselves. We're going to be looking at ourselves. Praise God. So let's start off and let's look at the purpose of Christ's ministry. Now, if you look at this particular account, I just said or mentioned that these people were tempting Christ, and they were emphasizing on one thing: save yourself and save others. Save yourself and save others. Save yourself and save others. The leaders, and they came and they said, the elders, the people, save yourself and save others if you be Christ, according to verse 35. And then the centurions also, the soldiers, they said the same thing again. Praise God. 36. When they were mocking him, they gave him vinegar. He said, save yourself and save others. And the thief that was on the cross also, he said, save yourself and save others. Praise God. But what these people do not understand, what they do not know was, take note very deep. Whatever they were accusing Jesus Christ for was what he was actually doing at this particular time. Praise God. Whatever they were accusing Jesus for, or whatever they were sort of like proposing towards his mission, they were proposing to him that he should save himself and save others. Unknowingly to them, that was the core of his ministry. That was the dream. That was his vision. And that was why he came, and that was what he was actually doing at this particular time, unknowingly to these very same people. Now, if you look at your Bible carefully, you see that the purpose of Christ's ministry is to save sinners. You can see carefully in the book of St. John, chapter 12, verse 47. St. John, chapter 12, verse 47. The Bible says, Christ came to save sinners. In Luke, chapter 19, verse 10, Christ came to save sinners. In 1 Timothy, chapter 1, verse 15, Christ came to save sinners. So that was his purpose. And that was the vision. That was the ministry of Jesus Christ. Praise God. Secondly, he didn't just came to save sinners, but the Bible says he came not to condemn the world. He didn't come to condemn the world. According to St. John, chapter 3, verse 17. Write these scriptures down because there is so much that I want to share, so that's why I'm going fast. Praise God. St. John 3, 17, he came not to condemn the world. Number three, the third purpose why he came was to fulfill the law. Because the law was against us. The law was a schoolmaster. But according to Matthew chapter 5 verse 17, he came to fulfill the law. Another purpose why he came was to minister and to give us life. To minister and to give us life. And how did he go about this? He came, the Bible says, and he sacrificed himself. In fact, the scripture says he didn't come to be ministered to, but to minister. In other words, he ministered to others by sacrificing his life, according to Matthew chapter 20, verse 28. Praise God. Hallelujah. Number five, the fifth purpose as to why he came was to preach the kingdom of heaven. That is the kingdom of God. According to Luke chapter 4, verse 43, he came to preach the kingdom of heaven, which is the kingdom of God. Number six, he came to send fire upon the earth. He came to send fire upon the earth. According to Luke chapter 12, verse 49. Number seven, he came to open the eyes of the blind. Praise God. He came to open the eyes of the blind. St. John chapter 9, verse 39. St. John 9, 39. Praise God. He also came to give us life and life abundantly. He came to give us abundant life, according to St. John chapter 10, verse number 10. He came to be a witness of the truth. He himself is the truth. He's the way, the truth, and the life. But then he came to be a witness of the truth, according to St. John chapter 18, verse 37. Jesus came to serve. He came to serve, according to Mark chapter 10, verse 45. He came to serve, as I said, not to be served. Praise God. He came to set the captives free. You and I were captives of sin. We were held in bondage and we were doomed to hell. But thank God he came to set the captives free. According to Luke chapter 4, verse number 18. Isaiah 61, verse 1. Isaiah 61, verse 1. Praise God. He also came to restore us to himself. He came to restore us back to himself. According to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 18 and 19. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 18 and 19. He came to restore us to himself. Praise God. Hallelujah. Now, looking at the purpose of Jesus' ministry as to why he came, you will discover that he didn't come for himself. Jesus Christ did not come for himself, but instead he came for you and I. He came for us. So listen to this now. It is because of your interest, because of you, that Jesus came. It is because of us, because of you and I, that Jesus came. Praise God. Hallelujah. And the Bible says he endured this crucifixion. He kept his focus. Even when he knew, Jesus is God, but then he knew that having paid the price, shed his blood, gave his life, he knew that yet some of us will deny him. He knew that some of us will not accept him. He knew that some of us, having accepted him, will backslide. He knew that some will even struggle to believe him. Praise God. And yet the Bible says, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Praise the name of our God. Hallelujah.
He was mocked. He was ridiculed. He was abused, disgraced. Above all, listen to this now. They chose Barabbas above Jesus Christ. They reproached Jesus. They let go of Barabbas. Praise God. They hung Jesus on the cross and they let go of a sinner. And that was his mission, to set the captives free, to save sinners. But my question to you, looking at the purpose of Jesus Christ here on earth and his ministry, hallelujah, the question that I would love to ask is, why Jesus? Why? Why Jesus? Why not an angel? Why not another creature or another being? Why Jesus? And Jesus is God. Now pay attention very deep. If you miss this, you're going to miss a whole lot that I'm about to teach. The reason why it has to be Jesus and it has to be God is because there is no one else, there is nothing else, and there is no other power that will be able to save us from our sin or our sins. Why? Because we are the image of God. Take note of this now. We are the image of God. Praise God. That's number one. Number two, we bear the breath of God. The life of God is in us. The life of God is in us. So that breath that we're breathing, you assume is an oxygen, it is the life of God. Now, if we bear the image of God, if we bear the life of God, and now we are lost and we ought to be saved and we need to be restored or redeemed, there's no power, there's nothing, there's no other image, or there's no other creature that God will use to redeem us but himself. Because he is the only one that have what it takes. That is why in the book of Hebrews chapter 10 verse 5, the Bible says that the blood of bulls and goats could not remove our sins. Instead, what they were doing was to cover us or cover the sin because of from the wrath of God, so that the judgment of God will not rest on us. Praise God. Hallelujah. Now, having said this, I want you to pay attention, because when we looked at our text, we see the fulfillment of the ministry of Jesus Christ. Now, looking at all the scriptures that I gave you, you realize that the focus is you and I, us, humans, people. Praise God. Now, looking at the questions that the elders were asking Jesus, the centurion asked Jesus, and the thief on the cross asked Jesus, these questions were directed to the ministry of Jesus Christ. These questions are exactly as to the mission and the ministry, or the purpose of Jesus' ministry. Praise God. They were saying, save us and save yourself. Or you say you are the Savior, save others and save yourself. But then Jesus' ministry, look at all that I've given you, all the scriptures just now, clearly indicates that Jesus came to save us. It clearly reveals that the ministry and the purpose of Jesus is to save sinners from our sins. Praise God. Hallelujah. So let's take a little bit of time and let's get into the text as we look at the second point, which is fulfillment of Christ's ministry. Fulfillment of Christ's ministry. Let's go back to chapter 23 of the book of Luke. And we're going to go into some details. Praise God. Are we there? Luke 23. Let's look at verse 32, 33, 34. And there were also two other malefactors led with him to be put to death. Praise God. 33. And when they were come to the place which is called Calvary, there they crucified him, and the malefactor one on the right hand and on the other on the left. That is just a summary. Praise God. Now look at the details. 34. The details actually began with Jesus saying, then said Jesus in 34, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Praise God. And they parted his raiment and cast lots. Father, Forgive them, for they know not what they do. Praise God. Now listen, this is very interesting. The very first thing that came out of the mouth of Jesus Christ was forgiveness. Forgiveness. Father, forgive them. Now, may I say this to you before we proceed? This was God's design. This was God's plan. So whatever we're going to be reading now, we're going to get into some of these details, but don't you forget this, that this is the will of God. This is the design of God. In other words, this is how God wants it to happen. And because this is the way it should be done, so that you and I will be saved. So the very first thing Jesus clearly made known was his forgiveness. Whatever you are going to do, you will do, but I have already forgiven you. Father, forgive them. Do you know that the entrance to your salvation is forgiveness? Salvation begins with two major things. Number one, repentance. Number two, forgiveness. Forgiveness is a privilege. Forgiveness is an opportunity. If God did not grant you the access to be forgiven, trust me, you will not have salvation. The Bible says no one will come to the Father except he called him. Praise God. So it is God that will give you access to repentance, and that will lead you to forgiveness. Praise God. And if God doesn't permit you, you won't get it. Amen. So the Bible says, Jesus clearly said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And this is true. How do we know that these people do not even know what they were doing? Jesus was busy helping them. Jesus was fulfilling his ministry of salvation to save these people. And yet they were asking Jesus to save himself and save others. So they don't know what was going on, and they did not even actually know what they were doing. Praise God. What they were doing was a fulfillment of the ministry of Jesus, but they didn't know that. What they were doing was a process for their own salvation, our salvation, but they didn't know that. What they were doing, they thought they were disgracing God. They thought they were crucifying Jesus. They thought, oh, they were accusing him. We're going to shed his blood. We're going to embarrass him. But unknowingly to them, what they were doing was the fulfillment of God's plan for their own. And Jesus said, for they know not what they do. You know, sometimes one of the strange things that will happen to you is that you are involved in certain things and you do not know the outcome, or what the outcome will be, or 2-3 years down the road, a few months down the road, something happened to you and you don't know why God permits it. You don't know why God accommodates such things to come to your way, or why God had to sort of like take you through. I see a lot of people accusing Jesus as not the Savior. People accusing Jesus as not the Son of God. People accusing Jesus as not God, even from other religions. And it's the same thing that these people were doing. Or you say you are the chosen one, save yourself and save others. Or you say you are the Son of God, save yourself and save others. Or you say you are the Messiah, save yourself and save others. They made ridicule of him. They made fun of him. But what they didn't know was that Jesus had already forgiven them, and he was helping them. May I say this to you? Wow. It took the grace of God for Jesus to forgive before he even started the mission. Because you know what? You know what? The most paramount task there was for God to forgive mankind for our sins. So you know what Jesus did? Before he even started off, he decided to forgive them. Because he knew what he was heading to. He knew what these people were capable of doing. Because crucifixion at that particular time was not a pleasant experience. It was very terrible, very destructive, very damaging. It was not just an open disgrace, like what the scripture says, curse is everyone that is hung on a tree. But it was an excruciating experience, a painful, terrible experience. When you are hung on the cross, your blood will drain down to your feet, and you will lose your breath. You'll be gasping for many, many terrible things. You begin to feel all your pores and all your nerves, and you, oh my goodness, everything will be painful because everything is being drained off of you. So Jesus had decided to forgive them. So in case you are already forgiven. Now let's settle that, because I am going to say some deep things as we go. Praise God. Amen. Now look at verse 35. 35 said something. He said, the people stood beholding, and the rulers also with them derided him, saying, he saved others. At this time, the work was not yet done. It was the process. But they were accusing him of saving others. Let him save himself, if he be Christ, the chosen of God. Praise God. 36, the same thing. 36, the same thing. He says, and the soldiers also mocked him, coming to him and offering him vinegar, 37, and saying, if thou be the king of the Jews. In verse 35, he says, if you are the chosen one. In verse 36, if thou be the king of the Jews. Praise God. In 37, if thou be the king of the Jews, save thyself. Now take note of these words. He's the chosen one. Is he not the chosen one? He is. Is he not the king of the Jews? Yes, he is the king of the Jews. Now, look at what they were saying. Save thyself. Listen to this. In fact, the Bible says, if Jesus had wanted to deliver himself, he could have called 10,000 angels. Maybe he doesn't even need 10,000 angels. Maybe just one. Maybe he doesn't even need an angel. Just at the breath, because listen, he is God. Just at the breath of his nostril, he will just, should I use the word extinct? Everyone that were there at that particular time, he would just destroy them, damage them, finish everybody. But he didn't do that. He could have done that. What they did not understand was that, take note now, Jesus was not lost. He was the Savior. The Savior doesn't need salvation. He was saved. He doesn't need salvation. In fact, he doesn't need to be saved because he was perfect. But look at them. They were telling him to save himself from what? What they were doing? That was nothing. They don't even know that what they were doing was part of the process of God's design. So they were saying, save yourself and save others. Now, take a look at this. If these people actually saying, save yourself and save others, if Jesus had adhered to this instruction or to this temptation, you know what would have happened? They would have been lost forever. You and I would have been lost forever. There would have been no church. There would have been no salvation. But they didn't understand what was going on. That is why I told you 34, Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they were doing or what they do. They are saying, save yourself. If Jesus had stopped himself from going to that cross, you and I would have been hellbound. Praise God. If Jesus has sort of like yielded to their temptation, they called him the Christ, they called him the King of the Jews. They asked him to save others and to save himself. Jesus said, not a word. The Bible says he opened not his mouth according to Isaiah. He didn't say a word. Now, take note of this. These people, take note, they do not understand what God was doing at that particular time. And Jesus was the only one upon the face of the earth who knew what was actually going on. Even before time began, he knew what the process was supposed to be. So look at what was happening. He kept quiet. He knew that if he had refused to go to that cross, that was why at the Garden of Gethsemane, he was saying, Lord, not my will, die be done, die be done. The Bible says that the sweat that was coming off of him was like blood because he knew what was going on. You know, let me say this to you. It is hard when the devil tempts you, and you know this is of the devil. But it becomes worse when the people that you came to save, or the people that you are going to the cross for, or the people that you are going to shed your blood for, they are part of the temptation, and they are the one increasing the pressure upon your life. Thank God, he prayed. Thank God, he kept his focus. Thank God, he was determined. And thank God, he didn't look at them. He kept doing what he was doing. Beloved, if you're going to fulfill God's plan or purpose for your life, take note now, you must be very careful of your very self. You must be very careful of the people that God led you to, or the people that you are serving. Praise God. You must be very careful of their temptations. I must say it again. You must be very careful of yourself so you don't give up. You must be very careful of the very people. You must be very careful of their temptations. Because let me say this to you. Let me say this. I wanted to wait, but I think it's necessary for me to say it now, and I will come back to that. The same temptation that Satan exposed Jesus to was the very same temptation that this man and these people, the leaders and the soldiers and the thief on the cross, it was the very same temptation they exposed Jesus to. So in other words, Satan was saying, what I could not do by myself, I will allow people to do it. Maybe they might succeed. And I've seen many pastors, many leaders, many Christians, many believers out there, many people who have missed the mark, their ministry had come to an halt or an end. Why? Because what the devil could not do, men were able to do it on behalf of the devil. Yes, I must say that again. Whatsoever the devil could not do by himself, he employed men, and most of those men were successful to destroy their ministries and the calling of other people. But thank God Jesus didn't allow that. So what Satan could not do, having tempted Jesus, you remember when he finished this fasting for 40 days and 40 nights, he says, if you are the Son of God, turn this stone to bread. He was asking just like this people, if you are the Son of God, if you are the Savior, if you are the Messiah. And then having said that, he was trying to build his ego, and he says, turn stone to bread. Bow down and worship me. Throw yourself over the cliff, and he will give his angels charge over thee. If you are. In other words, they were appealing to the pride of Jesus for him to yield. Be careful when you are exposed out there. When God is using you. When you are anointed. When you are called by God. When God gives you a ministry. He gives you a gift. You have some endowment of the grace of God upon your life. You'll be exposed to so many things out there. Some of them is an opportunity for you to demonstrate power. It could be an opportunity for you to demonstrate miracles, signs, and wonders. It could even be an opportunity to showcase yourself. And what you didn't even know is that you are going to obey the devil and lose your ministry. You might not even understand that. Oh, they said I cannot pray for the sick. Okay, bring him here. You can pray for that sick at that particular time. They will be healed because it's a gift and a grace that God will not take from you. But that obedience to the devil alone has shut down your calling, shut down your ministry if you're not careful. The day you obey Satan, the Bible says, whoever you obey, you become slave to that individual. So Jesus will never obey the instruction or the temptation from the devil. Whether it's coming directly or indirectly through a man, Jesus will never yield. So whatever he could not get Jesus to do, having fasted 40 days and 40 nights in the wilderness, he employed people to do it. And Jesus says, wow, I still see you walking among them or with them. But I know your trend. I know how you go, so I can handle this. Many of us out there were tempted to demonstrate power. You know, the world is appealing for power now. We're tempted to demonstrate miracle. We're tempted to preach and say certain things. We're tempted, you know, to sort of like gain a platform or gain an audience. So you go out there to showcase yourself. God says, you are missing it. Don't you try. And if you are naive spiritually, or you are ignorant of the ways or the devices of the enemy, you may think that this is an opportunity. Let me show. Jesus didn't demonstrate anything. He was actually doing it, but he was doing it in his own way as God, not in the ways of the devil. Because you know what Satan wanted to do was to stop Jesus from going to that cross. He wanted to stop him. If he had saved himself, there would have been no crucifixion, there would have been no death, there would have been no burial, there would have been no resurrection, and for salvation, forget it. There would have been no salvation. So, but thank God. He says, I'm not going to go down your path. Praise God. They refer to him as King of the Jews according to verse 38. And he was, and he is, and he still be forever King of the Jews. Praise God. Hallelujah. You know, most times in life, we do like these people. We misunderstood our helpers like they misunderstood Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Not only that, we accuse those that God have sent towards us for our own good. Why? Because of ignorance. We don't understand. I've seen people who curse their pastors. I've seen people who disrespect men of God. I've seen people who talk a lot of nonsense and foolish things against churches and church people. I've seen people who make sarcastic comments against God, against the word of God, and against the Christian faith. And what they didn't know is that what they are looking for is tied to a particular man. Maybe the very pastor that they don't like Jesus. It's tied to a church that they don't want to go. It's tied to a people that they hate. It's connected to a faith, like the Christian faith, that they despise. And that is what you actually want for your life to be meaningful, and you're despising it. So most times we misunderstand or accuse our helpers like these people were doing. Hallelujah. Jesus was able to save himself. But if he had done that, that would have been the end. You and I would have permanently been a candidate for hell. And you and I we would have not been able to know the Lord, to serve the Lord, or to make heaven. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If he had done so, we would not have been saved. Now look at this temptation. As I said, their temptation is just like what the devil did. Look at it. It says, if he is the Son of God, the target was for him to showcase himself. As I said, that's number one. Number two, the target was for him to demonstrate his pride, to say, I am the Son of God, and let me show you that I'm the Son of God.
Wow.
This is going for men of God out there, church leaders, women of God, believers. Never you allow the world to dictate their affairs or their will for your life, and you go out there trying to please them. Jesus never did that. This temptation was to hinder what Jesus was doing. Praise God. Look at it. So they wanted Jesus to demonstrate his pride. If you are the chosen, if you are the Son of God, if you are the Savior, save yourself and save us, or save others. Tell the devil, say, devil, I am not going to obey you. Devil, Jesus was able to turn stone to bread. He could have jumped over that cliff and nothing would have happened. Yeah. But at the obedience of Satan, would have enslaved him to be a candidate of sin and make him a sinner. And that would have been the end of our salvation. But look at it now. Jesus rejected that pride or that prideful temptation to demonstrate himself, to showcase himself. Praise God. The second thing was that they wanted him to act in obedience to the devil's instruction. So they wanted Jesus to obey the devil. Satan always wants you to obey him. If you are the son of God, preach this message. If you are a man of God, do this miracle. If you are a man of God, say this. If you are a man of God, go there. If you are a man of God, why would you show? Why would you let them know? Why would you let them see? Why would you prove yourself? No, you have no reason to. Listen, no one else calls you but God. So you have no reason to prove yourself to anyone but to God. And ministry is not about showcasing yourself. Ministry is not about the demonstration of power. Ministry is about glorifying God, pleasing Almighty God, because he's the one that called us. That is why in ministry, listen to this now, never you compete yourself with others. Never you have that aspiration or inspiration to become like your papa. You will never be your papa. No. There is going to be a transferring of anointing from your papa to you, but you will never be your papa. No. Because the gift, the calling, and the level of grace are different. Don't stand out there and try to preach like another man of God. You are phonetizing like a man of God that you know, or you are trying to sound like your mentor, or you are trying to preach your voice. You are trying to manipulate your voice so that you can sound like your bishop or your overseer. No, that is just flesh. That is flesh. That is ungodliness. That is manipulation. Praise God. If the anointing comes on you, erupts on you, you can sound like him, you can speak like him, but don't try to manipulate. By doing so, you are yielding to the suggestions of the devil. If you are anointed, do it like the way brother is doing it. Do it like the way that apostle would do it. Do it like the way that prophet said he prophesied about A, B. Why would you prophesy? And you begin to give fake prophecies. Why? Because you want to be like apostle or prophet so and so and so. So the devil is tempting you now. And these are the reasons why young men in ministry these days, they are straying away. They are straying away. They are looking for the platforms that God has not given to them. So they want to be like A, they want to be like this. So today they are pastor. The other day they call themselves evangelist. The other day they say, I am apostle. The other day they say, I'm a father in the Lord. Who makes you father, apostle, pastor, bishop? All this title. What are you looking for? You are confused. You are really, really confused. Be yourself. When you be yourself, take note. You will not compete yourself with others. You will not. Listen. These are the strategies of the devil. That is why there is so much confusion in the body of Christ today. Hey, bro, what's your name? Oh, don't call me bro. I'm apostle. Apostle what again? Nonsense. Hey, bro. What? No. I'm not your contemporary. I'm archbishop. I'm bishop. So and so. To them, the title is much more important. They are yielding to the temptations of the enemy. If you are the son of God, save yourself and save us. You are satisfying the ego of the people. Maybe as a pastor, like myself, you're standing behind the pulpit. You are ministering to the Lord according to what God has given you. And then suddenly you look at the atmosphere of the congregation. They want what is contrary to what God is saying. And instead of you going in accordance with whatever God is saying, you want to satisfy the people. And you say, everybody shout, lift up your hands, and shout, and shout, and shout. You want them to feel very lively. You're sort of like speaking to their emotions. You don't want anyone to get hurt, no one to feel bad. You know, I just want to give them what they actually want. You know, this young generation, I just want them to understand that. You know, and I want to be on their level. You're missing the mark. Jesus was neither on the level of the centurion soldiers, nor on the thief. In fact, let me shock you. I will show you something about what happened between Jesus and the first guy on the left-hand side, the thief. In fact, let me say, Jesus didn't say a word to him. Jesus didn't say a word to the guy on the left-hand side, the one that was tempting him. He didn't have time with him. He was saying, we're not on the same level. I have my focus. To the centurions, He was also saying deep down in his heart, I have no word for you. We're not on the same level. I keep my focus. We're talking about the ministry of Jesus Christ now. Some of you want to reply to everybody. You want to respond to the activities of others. You want to respond to every invitation. You want to respond to every comments online. You want to respond to everything you see out there. You want to make a comment. You want, oh my goodness. That is why we're fighting each other in the body of Christ. Someone died recently in Nigeria. Oh boy, that thing has become the order of the day now. This one is talking, this one is saying that, that one is saying that. Everybody is making comment. I have no comment. I have none. Not a single comment. If you know what is right, abide by it. The scripture is clear. By their fruits, we shall know them. If you are of God, we will know. If you are not of God, we will know. Don't join those who are confused. Don't join the confused. No. Look at it carefully. The Bible says that this man, they came to Jesus and they were tempting him to do things that he wasn't supposed to do. They wanted him actually to do it their own way. Praise God. Hallelujah. Save yourself and save others. So the temptation was for him to demonstrate pride, as I said. Number two, the temptation was for him to obey the devil instruction. Hallelujah. And then the temptation was for him to be misled. Save a few thieves out there. And then don't go to the cross. That would have been the end. Every single one of these three temptations leads to sin. Whether he would have saved them because of his pride, that would have been sin. He would have saved them and yielded to the obedience of the devil, that would have been sin. He would have saved them on his own way or his own way, that would have also been sin. Look at verse 39. I love this. I love this. Now take note. We're going to get deeper now. And one of the male factor, that is the thief, which were hanged, railed on him, saying, if thou be Christ, save thyself and us. You see that there? This was the guy I was talking about. Jesus did not even respond to him. There are some people, don't even look at their faces. Don't listen to them. All the garbage or the nonsense they want to say, just let it come here and go out of this part and then no comment. Nothing, absolutely. Jesus, the Bible says, listen to this guy. Then look at what the Bible says in verse 39. The Bible says, and one of the male factor which were hanged, railed. You see the word there that was used? I don't know what translation you were using. I'm using King James. Railed on him. It's like yelling at him or screaming at him. How can you be doing that to Almighty God? Saying, if thou be the Christ, save thyself and us. What you see here? Arrogance, pride, anger. Praise God. He was querying the identity of Jesus Christ. In other words, he was questioning the identity of Jesus Christ. If you are the Son of God, if you are the Savior, why won't you save us? If you are the Christ, was he not the Christ? Yes. Was he not the Christ? Yeah. It's like somebody say, if you are a man, you open your mouth. If you are a man, try it and open your mouth. You are a man. What do you open your mouth? You don't open your mouth. You are a man. Don't break your head. Praise God. If you are crazy, you make a move. I'll teach you a lesson. Hey, I'm not crazy. So whether I make a move or don't make a move, that doesn't determine whether I'm crazy or not. Praise God. So Jesus, I believe he would have turned on the left side to look at this guy. He says, wow. And he turned again. nailed on him to query his identity. What you see here is wrong approach, a negative preconceived idea about who Jesus is. His mindset was wrong. Hallelujah. He was asking Jesus to save himself. And what this ignoramus doesn't know was that Jesus was actually saving him. Whatever he was accusing Jesus for, that was what he was doing. But he was doing it in accordance to the word or with the will of God, not according to their own ways. So he was actually saving this man. He was not just saving him. Listen now. He wasn't even concerned about the cross that the man was hanging. He was saving this man's souls. He was saving his eternal. He was sort of like giving him eternal life at that particular time. The process that Jesus Christ was working on was for his eternal salvation. He was saving him from that which was worse than crucifixion, which is hellfire. But the guy didn't know. Hallelujah. So whatever he was accusing Jesus of not doing was what Jesus was truly doing. I'm going to say that again. Whatever this guy was accusing Jesus of not doing was what he was actually doing. And my question was, when I was reading this scripture, I'm like, God, what's the problem with this guy? What's the problem? And I want to ask you over there. Those of you who are watching out there, it's a Bible study. But my question to you is, what's your problem? Why are you angry? In fact, the very first thing that you should be concerned about is that what got this guy to the cross? What got him there? Oh Lord, you see, they say you are Jesus. Oh, you are the Savior. And God, I'm dying of HIV. How did you get to that level of HIV? You were sleeping around, right? Messing around. And you never said, oh Lord, at that time, you were enjoying all the ladies or all the guys around town until he catch up with you. Oh Lord, I'm in prison. And they say you are the Savior. Lord, why would you save me from this? Was he the one that sent you out there to pull the trigger or to stab somebody or to break the bank? Oh Lord, look, I'm struggling with this disease, this venereal disease. How did you catch that venereal disease? Lady, you were running around with the guys. You want to blame God for that. You want to point your fingers into the eyes of Jesus and say, if you are the Savior, save yourself and save us. It's not his responsibility to come anyhow, right? And just do anyhow because you want him to do anyhow. You are not his God. In fact, he is your God. How did he get to the cross? In fact, if you look at the next verse, verse 40, you will see the other guy on the right responding by letting him know that we are the cause for this. We cause this on ourselves. So don't blame this man. Praise God. Whatever he was accusing Jesus about was his own doing. Why was he there? He was there because of a crime he committed. And so he was judged lawfully and he was supposed to be crucified according to the law in those days. May I ask you a question? It may be that you have been disappointed, not because God wants you to be disappointed, but that was your choice to go down that path and you experience disappointment. You say, but Pastor, this man, my husband, is beating me like a drum in the house. He's taking advantage of me. But before you say, I do, did you actually consult God and say, God, is this the will, your will for my life? No, you took upon yourself. Hey, he's cute. He has money. Oh, I like him. He came from so and so country. I go, that's good. That like him. Listen. That liking that you was jumping, oh, I like him, that liking will come to an end after you say, I do. It's going to be reality now. I was talking to somebody the other day, and I said to him, be careful of your decision towards marriage. It determines your eternity. So, Pastor, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. I can handle it. I can handle it. A few months down the road, he came back feeling disappointed because what he was anticipating doesn't work for him. You want to invest. You want to join business with someone. You never consulted the Lord. You know, somebody comes and they sing your praise. Oh, you're a nice guy. You know, if you put your money there, it will work, it will work. They were tempting you and you yielded to that temptation, not knowing that it was a trap. Oh, let's move from Toronto. Let's go down to Winnipeg. Oh, let's go to Edmonton. Let's go to Calgary. Is it the will of God for you to move? Oh, I don't like this church here. I want to go to a church where they have an apostle. Oh, I don't like an apostolic church. I'm looking for a prophetic ministry. Oh, I don't like a prophetic ministry. I'm looking for a deliverance ministry. You keep moving, you become a church prostitute. From one church to the next, one church to the next. Up till today, you do not have any abiding city. You are still moving. Church prostitute. Am I insulting you? Nope. Am I making sense to you tonight? Hallelujah. You tend to make decisions based on the suggestions of other people. You tend to make decisions based on the ideology of the system. You tend to make decisions based on the culture that you find yourself in. You tend to make decisions based on the opportunities that are available. You don't make decisions in accordance with the word of God. That will frustrate your life. You want to do what other people are saying, what other people want you to do. Haven't you seen in this country, people, when most of us come in as migrants or immigrants, when we come in, after a few months down the road, your friend, go join this, go to school, go study this, go study that. Go. You keep studying, studying, studying. Some people have 4 or 5 degrees in this country without a single job. They ended up in the factory. What's the problem? They were not focused. They never paid attention to what God designed them to become. The Bible says, Jesus himself said, if a man is planning to build a house, he must first of all sit, count the costs, and know whether he is able. That was what Jesus did at the Garden of Gethsemane. He sat, he counted the cost, he prayed to the extent that the Bible said the sweat that came off of him was like blood. So when he was facing these charlatans now, it doesn't bother him. When he was facing all these ignoramus, when they were talking nonsense, doesn't bother Jesus. But because what? He sat, he thought about the price, the cost, and all what he was going to go through. He prayed about it. He settled himself. He says, wow, I'm ready for this. Hallelujah. So this guy was there because of the wrong choice that he made. He was there because of the wrong decision. Some of you are ending up being sick. You have a problem. You are going through failure, destruction, disappointment, and all these things that you are still accusing God. And what you totally forgot about was your decisions was independently yours. It was not the will of God. So Jesus didn't say a word to him. And listen to this, beloved. Every time you disobey God, there's one thing that God will always do, except otherwise, when he wants to show you mercy. But other than that, he will be quiet. And every time you did hear from God, cry. Cry until you hear. Pray, even if he doesn't want to talk, shout. Shake the entire house or church until you hear from God. If you don't, say, something is wrong somewhere. Praise God. Now, let's look at the second guy that was on the cross. Listen, this guy on the left, Jesus did not respond to him. But the guy on the right was the one that Jesus responded to. Praise God. Now, I'm going to tell you why he responded to the guy. But let me also let you know, in this life, be careful not to respond to those that are on the left. I'm not talking about political parties and issue now. When I talk about the left, I mean those who are on the wrong side. I mean those who are on the side of the devil. I mean those who are on the side of sin and worldliness and darkness and godliness.
Never you respond to them. I'm talking about those who are operating with the powers and forces of darkness. They try to deprive you, derail you, bring you to a halt. Don't respond to them. Look at verse 40. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Look at the next guy. The one on the right. He said, but the other answering rebuked him. This was the other guy, the other thief responding. Not Jesus. The other guy answering rebuked him. He rebuked the other thief saying, I love this. Does not thou fear God? Are you not afraid of God? Are you not afraid of the word? Are you not afraid of the power of God? Are you not afraid of the presence of God? Are you not afraid of the move of God? Are you not afraid of the hand of God? Are you not afraid of the glory of God? Are you not afraid of the judgment of God? Are you not afraid? What is wrong with you? What is wrong with you? Dost thou not fear God, seeing thou art in the same condemnation? When you read this particular verse, it reveals to you that this guy actually, even though he was wrong, but his heart condition was right. Number two, he fears God. Praise God. Number three, he was sincere. He was very, very honest. Number four, he judged God rightfully. He judged himself wrong and he judged the Lord truthfully or rightfully. In other words, he knew that Jesus was innocent. I will show you that. His heart condition was right. Praise God. Look at the very same verse 40. He says, but the other answering rebuke him, saying, dost thou not fear God? Seeing, look at this. Seeing thou art in the same condemnation. Verse 41. And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds. But this man had done nothing amiss. How did he know? You deserve what you are getting. I deserve what I'm getting. We ought to be crucified. We ought to die. But this man. But this God is this man. And this man is this God. I've done nothing amiss. Listen to this, beloved. This man, the Bible says, this thief was able to identify Jesus. Not only that, he was able to judge Jesus rightfully. And this man also proved the innocence of Jesus. Let me talk to some tongue-talking believers now. Christians, how many times we're angry with God because things don't go the way we want it to go? How many times we've abandoned church because why we were bitter? Because our expectations were disappointed. How many times you keep grudge against the pastor because he didn't pray for your child? How many times you get angry because you know you prayed and your husband died, you prayed and your wife died, and you say, God, I'm going nowhere anymore, no church anymore, no Bible study anymore, no prayer anymore. You're saying, God, why would you do this to me? You got fired. You come home. You kick the door. You kick everything around. You scatter your Bible. You ask her, honey, what's going on? Honey, calm down. What's the problem? He said, no, man, why would God do this to me? Why would God do this to me? Why would God do this to me? God didn't do you nothing. He didn't do you nothing. This man, look at it there. Look at it. I sense him. But this man had done nothing amiss. No mistake. God will never sin against you. God
never sinned against you. Libra dubia kasketea. God will never sin against you. So, but pastor, I remember several years ago, that was in 1992. I used to tell this story. I don't know if you may have heard this. I used to have a lady that was working at the bank at that particular time. Their relatives were part of the government, and they got overthrown by the military at that particular time. And this lady was homeless. Imagine she had a posh job at the bank, and she was living large. And she came one day. She said she wanted to talk to me, and I was like, "Yes, ma. Yes, what's the problem?" She said that which I have never heard in my life for the first time. She said, "Pastor, I must forgive God." I'll never forget that afternoon. I was sweating. Really, ma? Why? What happened? What is your problem with God? And she said, "Pastor, who is our mother in heaven?" I know they said God is our father in heaven. She didn't understand much. But who is our mother in heaven? Because I must forgive God because of what I'm going through. How will God allow me, you know, to live in a house like this when I was living larger? I used to make money. Before I asked her the question that I wanted to ask her, I was shivering. I was covered in sweat and cold because I've never heard that before. I must forgive God. Where would I go with this? What should I say to this woman? And finally, I got a word and I asked her, "Where was God when all was well with you?" And that was how she calmed down. And she was looking at me straight, eyeball to eyeball. She was looking at me like straight into my eyes. I was waiting for the next one that would come because I was like, "Lord, help me with this one." She's an elderly woman, you know. She's at that time, she was like a mother to me because as a young man, you know, in ministry, my very first church, I was confused. God gave me a word. Sometimes we want to point our fingers to say, "God, you didn't do this, you didn't do that, you didn't do that. And as such, I have all right not to go to church. I have all right not to pray. I have all right not to be a Christian anymore. But God, I'm tired of this. You know how many years I've been praying, God? You never responded." Listen. A man had a job. Listen and listen. I'll give you a few stories. A man had a job. Very well paid job. Well paid job. This man go to the job. He got fired the very same day, in the morning. The very morning he got fired, when he got to the job, a Christian. He picked up his stuff, he left. 1 hour after, there was an explosion in his department, in that particular location where he was working. Everyone else died. Everyone died, including the boss that fired him. He could have died, but he didn't know that God was saving his life. I hope you're learning. A lady was believing God for marriage. "Lord, I want this guy. Lord, this man. Oh, this, that, that, that." The man is wealthy and everything. The man proposed, and the Lord says no. Got to the pastor, they talk, and the pastor says no. What she didn't understand was that the guy was one of those roamers around who have seen a beautiful, lovely, godly sister that he can make a wife. But he didn't know that this guy carried excess luggage of HIV. So, the pastor said, "I don't know, I don't have a breakthrough. I don't think it is right. I don't know, but this guy just came to the church and then it's too soon." The lady was like, "No, pastor, no, 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 you don't want to break my marriage. This, no, 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 no." You know women like that when they are zealous, the guy is rich and then he looks good. And then one day they were in the church, another lady popped into the church and saw this guy, shocked, surprised. "I used to know this guy." And unfortunately for this guy, this lady that came into the church went and asked the very lady she was supposed to marry, "Do you know this man? Is this Mr. So and so and so and so?" She says, "Yes, I know him."
Wait, is he not the guy that they said have HIV and AIDS?
Right there, she was trembling. She was confused. What did you just say?
Is this not the guy they said have said it again? I'm not,
God forbid, don't misunderstand me. Don't misunderstand me. I'm not talking bad about those people who have HIV and AIDS, but I'm just giving you an example. So if you are one of those, don't feel bad. Forgive me if you get mad. But what she didn't know was that God was preserving her from getting into the wrong hands. Many times God will stop certain things from happening and you don't know why. These guys were accusing Jesus, not knowing that Jesus was working on their behalf. These guys were provoking, abusing, embarrassing Jesus, not knowing that this very same Jesus was working on their behalf. The Bible says this man had done nothing amiss. This man had done nothing amiss, verse 41. And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds. Okay, but this man had done nothing amiss. Praise God. You see, God will always raise someone that will vindicate you. He will always raise, listen, no matter how people lied against you, about you, talk about you, don't worry. Don't you worry. Don't fight. Don't go out there and show yourself. No, that's not part of the ministry of Jesus to fight. No. So let it be. The guy had the right mindset. His heart condition was right. Praise God. And look at it. Look at it. Look at it. I like what he says afterwards. In verse 42. He says, and he said, he didn't just talk about Jesus. He didn't just commend Jesus. He didn't just love Jesus. He didn't just judge Jesus rightfully. But he took a step. Verse 42. He said unto Jesus, Lord. When I read this, I'm like, that's it. That's it. He got it right. He confessed him as Lord. These other guys never. In fact, they accused him as Lord. He confessed him as Lord. They accused him as a savior in 35. They accused him as the son of God. They accused him as the chosen one. They accused him as the king of the Jews. But look at this man. He confessed him as Lord. Wisdom. Wisdom. Right judgment. He knew the real and true identity of Jesus Christ. Listen to this. Beloved, until you are able to identify God, until you are able to identify the true identity of Jesus Christ, you will never be able to identify yourself. Until you recognize who God is before you gain recognition of yourself. You remember Peter? Jesus was saying, who do men say that I am? Oh, they said this. Don't go there. Who do you say that I am? And then he says, you are the Christ, the Son. And Jesus says, thou, his name changed right away. His own identity was revealed by Jesus. He says, thou art Peter. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thou art what? Simon. Thou art the rock. Praise God. Hallelujah. And Jesus says, upon this rock, I will build my church. He revealed the identity of Jesus, and Jesus also revealed his own identity. Until you can identify God, you will never be able to get your own true identity in Jesus' name. So the Bible says, Peter revealed who Jesus was. And this man said, he said it clearly. He says, and he said unto Jesus, Lord, he called him Lord. That is, you are in control. To be Lord over your life is to be in control. Is to be subjected to. Hallelujah. It's for Jesus to reign in his life. And he said something again that is so wonderful. He says, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. Remember me. Haven't you read your Bible carefully when you discover that every time when the Bible says, and the Lord remembered Noah for an example, it was for his good. Every time when God made mention, and the scripture made mention, and the Lord remember Sarah, and the Lord remember Abraham, it's for their good. In other words, it's not like God is a God that will forget. No, he doesn't forget. In other words, God is saying, and the Lord remember. In other words, God is saying, and the Lord bring you to your own timing of fulfillment. In other words, God is saying, I acknowledge you. This is your time. This is your timing. Praise God. He says, remember me. Remember me. When thou comest into thy kingdom, remember me. So look at this. Look at this now. Wow, 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 wow. This man, he acknowledged the lordship of Jesus over his life. He made a very wise decision. Listen. This man also have what we call eternal view. He had the view of the future, the eternal view, the view of eternity. So he says, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. Remember me, Lord. So the man's focus was not even deliver me from this cross. Mm-mm. Death or not, my focus is eternity. Whereas this other guy was like, deliver me now. If you say you are the king of the Jews or you are the Messiah, the chosen one, what kind of nonsense is that? But look at this guy. His vision was for the future, unto eternity. Praise God. He was humble. He was willing. He accepted him as Lord. And then the Bible says, Jesus, listen to this now. Jesus did what he had never done for any. Before the cross. Before. Kambri dadusha kataka. Lembre debo shataya la. Kikoro bodeya. Listen, the Bible says, Jiste makaro dosiya la bodeya. And Jesus said unto him, verily, truly. Whenever you see verily, it means truly. This is not, it's not your doctrinal thing. Forget it. Forget your doctrine right now. I'm not saying your doctrine is wrong. I believe in sound doctrine. I know why I'm saying this. Look at this. It says, Jesus said unto him, verily I say unto thee, today, thou shalt, he says, shall thou be with me in paradise. Really? What about the doctrine of salvation? What about repenting, confessing Jesus Christ, accepting as a Lord and personal Savior? Praise God. What about water baptism? What about sanctification, holiness, righteousness? Hey! You know what Jesus did? He broke the doctrinal protocols. What Jesus did here was to push against the tradition and the customs of the scribes and the Pharisees. He breaks all traditional doctrinal protocol. He says, today, you will be with me. Today. Not tomorrow. Not next week. Not next year, but today. You know what Jesus looked at? The Bible says, man will judge at the outward appearance, but God looked at the heart. Jesus looked at the heart. And look at the confession of the man. He already confessed him as Lord. Praise God. He already confessed him as Lord. And he said unto Jesus, Lord, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thy heart that God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. But this man was saved, man. I'm so proud of him. He had his senses for his job. He was smart. He knew he was going to die. He says, you know what? This opportunity that I have, this at this 0 hour, no way, I won't let it go. Lord, Lord, don't leave me. Don't pass me by. Lord, this opportunity that you are side by side with me, Lord, this day will never come again. Lord, this chance to repent, Lord, this grace that I can see face to face to believe, Lord, this redemption, this mercy, this salvation will not pass me by. Remember me. And Jesus said, today. Today. Today, verily I say unto you, today thou shalt be with me in paradise. I can't wait to be with him. You and I should not be waiting now. We should be saying, Lord, remember me. Because, Lord, I can't wait to be with you in paradise. What a privilege. What a privilege. Listen. When the man called for remembrance, listen. Jesus acknowledged the man's cry. May I say this to you?
God will not turn his ears against your tears. He will not turn his ears against your tears. If you cry unto the Lord, he will hear.
Jeremiah 33 verse 3, call upon me and I will answer thee, and I will show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not.
Praise God.
Hallelujah. Verse 44, it says, and it was about the sixth hour, and there was a darkness over all the earth until the night hour, and the sun was darkened, and the veil of the temple was rent in the midst. Praise God. Which means that in 45, Jesus fulfilled the law. This was the fulfillment of the law. 46, and when Jesus had cried with a loud voice, he said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. You see that? Into thy hands. In other words, I give. Praise God. I hand over my spirit. So the death of Jesus Christ was him handing over his spirit unto the Father. Praise the name of the Lord. And when Jesus had cried with a loud voice, he said, Father, into thy hands I command my spirit. Praise. Command my spirit. And having said thus, he gave up the ghost. Now, when the centurion, look at 47. When the centurion saw what was done, he glorified God, saying, certainly, this man, this was a righteous man.
Even the centurion, this was one of them, again, that was girding.
The Bible says, when he saw what was done,
when he saw what was done by God, by the power of God, by the manifestation of the Spirit,
the cloud everywhere was dark, the manifestation of God's power. The Bible says, when he saw what was done, God will do it for you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. He glorified God, saying, certainly, this was a righteous man.
A righteous man. You see, another man has another encounter. A thief encounter. Then, look at this man now. He had an encounter that is undeniable. He says, certainly, 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 this was a righteous man. Certainly. Praise God. A righteous man.
Verse 47. He says, he glorified God.
Why was he glorifying God? Because of what he saw. He saw righteousness, he saw power, he saw the glory of God, he saw the grace, he saw the manifestation. He says he was a righteous, certainly, certainly.
Verse 48, he says, and all the people that came together to that sight, beholding the things which were done, they smote their breast like this and returned. You know, in those days, culturally, when somebody is doing this, it's a sign of pain. It's a sign of regret. It's a sign of repentance. It is also a sign of assurance of truth that really, 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 what have we done? This man, oh my goodness. Like the centurion says, certainly he's a righteous man. So they were like, what have we done? Oh my goodness. How do we allow such to happen? This crucifixion, this man is innocent. They smote their breast as a sign of regret, repentance. And also, as I said, as a form of assurance of who Jesus truly was at that particular time. Praise God. Hallelujah. May I say this to you? There are so many people, take note now, that will misunderstand you now. But tomorrow, they will realize who you really are. And it will be too late for some of them. And some will regret. Hallelujah. 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 And these are the reason why, as believers, we should be very careful looking at the ministry of Jesus Christ. We should be very, very careful so that you should not allow people, circumstances, or the devil to obstruct you. Be very careful so that you will not be obstructed, number one. Be very careful so that others, things, and situations will not act as an hindrance. Praise God. Be careful so that the enemy will not be able to destroy your visions in life. Praise God. Be careful because they might want to stop you. They might want to increase your pain, increase your frustration and your disappointment so that you will easily give up. But look at the example of Jesus Christ. He kept quiet. He was focused. He was steadfast till the very end. This leads us to our third point, which is Christ's focus and determination. Jesus was very determined. He was focused. And this is one of the reasons why the scripture says we should look unto Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, is our clear example. Don't get me wrong. Don't despise men of God. Don't despise churches. Don't despise leadership. But look at it below. You don't know what the end of that individual, that ministry, or that movement might be. You look unto Jesus, because a ministry might come to an end today, but Jesus still abides forever. He's still Lord. Someone might give up today, but Jesus is still Lord. So you must have that courage. You must have that zeal. You must be tenacious. You must be focused. The psalmist says in Psalm 57, verse 7 to verse 9, he says, my heart is fixed. My heart is fixed. In fact, let's look at it. Psalm 57. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We're going to be fast now. Psalm 57. Hallelujah. Are we there? Thank you, Holy Spirit. 57, verse 7 to verse 9. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Let's take it from verse 7. It says, my heart is fixed, O God, my heart is fixed. I will sing and give praises. Awake up my glory. Awake sanctuary and harp. I myself will awake early. I will praise thee, O Lord, among the people. I will sing unto thee among the nations. The Bible says, the psalmist says, my heart is fixed. My question to you is that, is your heart fixed? Praise God. Do you have a fixed heart? Do you have a fixed mind? Do you have a fixed desire? Do you have a fixed vision? Praise God. Are you keeping your focus? Hallelujah. Are you looking unto the Lord Jesus Christ? Hallelujah. In Psalm 108, verse 112, it says the same thing there. Psalm 108, verse 112, my heart is fixed. Let's look at some few examples in our Bibles, and then we're going to round up. David, for instance, you remember in the book of 1 Samuel, chapter 30, verse number 6, the Bible says, after the men came to Ziklag, they burnt everything. They took all their belongings, their wives and their children. The Bible says, the men wept until they could weep no more, and they spake of stoning David. Their intention was to stone David, but David didn't go out there to argue with them. The Bible says he encouraged himself in the Lord his God. He inquired from the Lord and he encouraged himself. Praise God. Why? David was a man of focus. He was determined. Praise God. He was a man of focus. So as we look at this third point, Christ, focus and determination, we must learn to be focused. Don't allow obstruction. Don't allow anyone to come and just snatch us anyhow. Don't allow disappointment. Don't allow discouragement. David was focused in the midst of depression, in the midst of weeping, in the midst of the loss. Yet, he could stand and inquire from the Lord, and he could also encourage himself in the Lord. Another person we should look at is blind Bartimaeus in the book of Mark chapter 10, verse 40 to 46. Mark chapter 10, verse 40 to 46. The Bible says, when he heard that Jesus was passing by, he cried the more. He pleaded the more. He shouted the more. The disciples and others, they come on, shut up. Why are you shouting so loud? Are you causing noise? Everybody else is busy. The Bible says, he cried the more. He cried the more. Thou son of David, have mercy on me. The Bible says, the men, they restrained him to be quiet. But then he was shouting. As they tried to stop him, he was shouting the more. His focus was to get the attention of Jesus. And he was able to get the attention of Jesus. Even though he was restrained to be quiet, he kept shouting because his focus was for Jesus to hear him, Jesus to get his attention. And the Bible said Jesus heard, and Jesus sent for blind Bartimaeus, and he said, what must I do for you? He says, thou that I might receive my sight. That was how he got his miracle. Why? He was very, very tenacious. He was very determined. What about Zacchaeus? The Bible says in the book of Luke chapter 19, verse 1 to verse 10, he was a short man in stature. Praise God. And the Bible says he heard that Jesus was passing by. He was in the midst of the crowd, but he could not see because he was like a dwarf. He could not see Jesus. So the Bible says he ran ahead. He knew where Jesus was heading to. He ran ahead. Can we run ahead? Can we run ahead tonight in prayer? Can we run ahead begging Lord to remember me? Like this guy said. Can we run ahead, begging ahead? Beg for the future. Beg for our children. Beg for our husbands. Beg for our wives. Beg for our family members. And say, Lord, remember us. The Bible says he ran ahead and he climbed. He climbed on the sycamore tree. Can we run ahead and climb? Climb on whatever we can climb upon. A sycamore tree, a wall, a stage, an altar. You can climb in prayer. You can climb in fasting. You can climb through the word. Whatever you can climb on, climb on it right now. Like Bartimaeus did. And Jesus walked under. Zacchaeus did. And Jesus walked under. He knew somebody was waiting for him. He knew somebody already gone ahead of him. He knew somebody is short. He knew somebody that is determined to see him. And he says, sir, please, Zacchaeus, can you come down? Today, I will get to be in your house. And the man was shocked. Right there, he started repenting. He decided to clean house. He was doing house cleaning. He decided to give everything that he had taken from others. Lawfully, praise God. What more can we say about Mordecai? You remember he was targeted by Haman. Hallelujah. That Haman wanted to execute and destroy all the Jews. Praise God. He hated Mordecai. Every time he would come and walk by the door, Mordecai would not look at him. He would pay attention to what God was doing, and he got bitter. He got angry. Who is this man? Who is this Jews? Who is this rubbish, foolish guy? He never greeted me. He never paid obeisance to me. He never respected me. And he decided to execute this guy. He built a gallows. According to the book of Esther chapter 5, verse 9 to verse 11, he plotted to kill Mordecai and to execute the Israelites. But then the Bible says, God favored him. God favored him. And then the Bible says, because he helped the king at what time, the king requested for the man that once helped and once revealed about the plot that was against him. And they brought Mordecai. And he asked him, what can I do? And that was when the secret was revealed. And you know what happened? The Bible says that Haman ended up in the gallows. Why? Mordecai was focused. He was quiet. He was determined. He kept his attention. He kept his dream alive, his vision alive to deliver his people. What more can we say about Elijah? The Bible says the time that Elijah was supposed to be taken away from Elisha, the Bible says the son of the prophet came to him and said, sir, where are you going? Your master is going to be taken away from you. He followed from Jordan to Gilgal, from Gilgal to Bethel. He kept following. They kept talking nonsense. Oh, don't you know your master will be taken away from you today? He says, hold your peace. In other words, he was saying to them, mind your business. It doesn't concern you. You mind your business. Where are you going? Why are you following this man? He says, mind your business. It doesn't concern you. Hold your peace. I know what I'm going after. I know what I'm chasing for. I know who I'm serving. I know what I'm looking for. He kept following until they get to the end of the destination. And the man of God said to Elisha, what do you want? And he asked for him to ask whatever he wants. And Elisha asked for a double portion of his anointing. And he says, really? You have asked a hard thing. But nevertheless, if thou can see me. He was also focused. He was persistent. He was determined. He was zealous. He wasn't going to allow the sons of the prophet to obstruct him. He wasn't going to allow any confusion, any hindrance. Nothing is going to deter him. Nothing is going to remove his focus away from the master. And the Bible says that very day, he said to him, he said, if you see me. And you know what happened at the end of it? He saw his master. His master be taken away with wild wind and the fire and the chariots of Israel. And he shouted with a loud voice, master, my master, the chariot of Israel. Right there, the Bible says the mantle that was on Elisha fell on Elijah. And before you know it, he came and he was doing double. In fact, he did much more than his master. Why? He kept his focus. He was determined. Praise God. Jesus himself is an example. The Bible says in Isaiah 53, verse number 7, all that we've just read from the book of St. John, the book of Luke, the Bible says he opened not his mouth. In Isaiah chapter 53, verse 7, he was led as a sheep for the slaughter. He opened not his mouth. He was quiet. You know, let me show you one strategy about against the enemy. Anytime the devil is trying to do things, or people around you are trying to fight against you, or there's conflict in the family, there's conflict in the church, there's a misunderstanding, one of the greatest treasure that I want to give you today is quietness. 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 This leads us to the fourth point, which is yourself. You must allow yourself to be quiet. Be focused and be quiet. Do not allow the enemies to have entrance into your life. In Isaiah chapter 30 verse 15, it says something about quietness. Isaiah chapter 30 verse 15, it says, in quietness and in confidence shall be our strength. It says, for thus saith the Lord God, the Holy One of Israel, in returning and rest shall ye be saved. In returning and rest shall ye be saved. Return unto the Lord and rest, and you shall be saved. And it says, in quietness and in confidence shall be your strength, and he will not. In quietness and in confidence, return and rest. Why are you breaking your head? Return unto the Lord. Why are you frustrated? Return unto the Lord. Why are you confused? Return unto the Lord. Why are you troubled? And the Bible says, in confidence. Confidence in his word, confidence in prayer, confidence by faith, confidence in the Holy Ghost, confidence in the purity of the grace of God, confidence in righteousness, it shall be well with the righteous, confidence in the promises of God, confidence in everything that has to do with God's word. Be confident. Keep your confidence in him. In quietness and in confidence shall be your strength. But the people of God could not listen. They will not hear. Praise God. May I say this to you? Most of the time, God is speaking and we are not listening. God gives instruction and we are not following. The Bible says, in quietness and in confidence shall be your strength, and you will not. God said, be quiet. You are a talkative. Every single thing you are explaining, every achievement you are explaining, every decision. And you know the worst thing now? Everything is online. You're going to go out, you're putting it online. You dress today, you put it online. You eat stew today, you put it online. You eat burger tomorrow, you put it online. You change your car, you put everything. Some people, even their living room is online. How would you be doing that? You give access to the enemy. Praise God. And so it's easy for them to find you. They don't have to go to the realm of the spirit. They just go and tap your name. They'll see everything on Facebook. They see your living room. They see your bedroom. They see your, what are you showing off? You are exposing yourself to the enemy. In quietness and in confidence shall be your what? Your strength. Learn to be quiet. Don't allow the enemy. The Bible says in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 2 verse 11 that we should not allow the devil to take advantage of us. The devil is always there to take advantage of us. In the book of Colossians chapter 2 verse 4 to verse 5, the Bible says we should not allow the enemies or the plan of the enemy to deceive us or for him to beguile us. He should not be able to deceive us by beguiling us. In the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 11 verse 3 and Colossians chapter 2 verse 4 to verse 5, the Bible says we should not allow the enemy to beguile us. Praise God. And finally, in the book of Romans chapter 14 verse 8, Romans chapter 14 verse number 8. I love this and we're going to pray with this. You should be God-centered and you should allow everything that has to do with your life and everything that has to do with what you are doing to be of God. Hallelujah. Romans chapter 14. Let everything be of God. Let everything be of God. Let everything be of God. Your life, your decisions, your focus, your visions and dreaming life, your finances, your marriage, your spiritual life, everything must be on God. You should be quiet, you should be focused, you should be patient, you should be disciplined, you should be determined, and let everything be of God. Romans chapter 14, can we read verse 8 together? It says, for whether we live unto the Lord. 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 The thief's cry, the thief cry, he says, Lord, remember me. Are you living unto the Lord? Whether we live unto the Lord. Are you living unto the Lord? Are you living in righteousness unto the Lord? Are you living in holiness unto the Lord? Are you living in obedience unto the Lord? Are you living faithfully unto the Lord? Are you living according to God's word? Praise God. Are you living unto the Lord in purity, in sanctity? Are you living unto the Lord in truth and honesty? Are you living unto the Lord? Hallelujah. Praise God. He said, whether we live unto the Lord. And whether we die unto the Lord. So So we live unto the Lord, we die unto the Lord, and whether we live therefore or die, we are the Lord's. We are the Lord's. Are you of the Lord? Are you of the Lord? Are you of the Lord, beloved? How do you build your ministry? Maybe you are a pastor. You are building your own structure your own way. You are doing your own things your own way. It is not in line with God's word anymore. You are not following after the examples of Jesus. You are following after the example of a prophet somewhere. You are following after the example of another man of God somewhere. You are following after the manual of another church somewhere. You are following after the design of another evangelist somewhere. Are you following after the ministry of Jesus Christ? Are you following after the steps of Jesus Christ? Are you following after the example of Jesus Christ? Remind you about 1 Peter chapter 2, 21. The Bible says Jesus Christ has given us an example that we should follow his steps. Follow the steps of the Lord, you will never fail. Follow the steps of the Lord, you will never be disappointed. Follow the steps of the Lord, you will never be ashamed. Follow the steps of the Lord, you will never die. Follow the steps of the Lord, he will lead you into perfection. He will lead you into righteousness. He will lead you into fulfillment. He will lead you into holiness. He will lead you to peace. He will lead you to fulfillment in life. And it shall be well with you. Maybe you are out there, you haven't given your life to the Lord Jesus Christ. You have never accepted him. I want you to know that tonight, God is calling you home. Come back home, bro. Come home, sis. God loves you. God is not against you. Just like the man that cried, the thief that cried. Don't be like those who are very critical. They have a critical mind. Like one of the ones, the guy that was on the left-hand side was critical. Oh, you said you are the Savior. Save yourself and save us. Don't be ideological. You have your own ideology. Oh, they said he's the Savior. Who is he? Well, let him do whatever he wants to do. No, 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 no. Your ideology will kill you. Praise the Lord. Your ideology will kill you. Your psychology will lead you to hell. Praise God. You are rationalizing anything and everything. You are philosophically minded. You have a kind of theory that you explain it scientifically. You explain it morally. You explain it socially. You explain it humanly. You never explain it biblically. Anything that is godly, you don't like it. Anything that is of God, you hate it. You try to do all kind of crafty kind of thing to put a kind of mindset or a kind of idea that contradict the word of God. Is it not enough for you? Won't you repent tonight? Won't you say, Lord, I am sorry. Lord, I've been giving excuses at your age, professor. You're watching me, you're a professor. You've misled a lot of people, professor. And then you know you are wrong. Or you're a politician. You've misled a lot of people. And you know you are wrong. You are religious in your own sect. You know you are wrong. You are a manager. You know you are wrong. You might even be a pastor and you know you are wrong. You might be a teacher or somebody, a family man or woman or husband or wife or a leader in a club, in a community. And you know you are wrong. You are misleading people. Why won't you lead them to Jesus? He says, I'm the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. If any man comes unto me, listen to this now. If you come to Jesus, he will not turn you back. His purpose is that you'll be saved. Can you come home tonight? Can you say, Lord, I'm sorry? Can you say, Lord, I am a sinner? Can you say, Lord, 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 like the guy cried and say, remember me? Remember me, Lord, over the years I have backslidden. Over the years I've lived in sin. At my age, Lord, 75, 68. Lord, at my age, 81. Lord, I have built so many kind of psychology and theory and philosophy and ideology that has crumpled my life, that has destroyed my health, that has destroyed the life of other people. Lord, I'm coming home tonight. Can we pray tonight? Everyone under the sound of my voice. Maybe you are in Africa, you are in Australia. I see blood in my hand right now. I see blood on my tongue. As I was speaking, I just see blood on my tongue, my hand. I don't know what is going on. I don't know what the Lord is saying. But I'm just pointing. As I'm pointing to you, I just see blood in my hand right now. I don't know. I just believe that the Lord is speaking to somebody. Praise God. I want to let you know that God loves you tonight. I want to let you know that God is not condemning you. I want to let you know that the blood of Jesus was shed for you at the cross. And the Bible says, the man cried, remember me. And the Lord says today, maybe you are at the point of death. I don't know whether you are dying tonight. I don't know you. I don't know you. I don't know where you are. Maybe you are in Australia. You are in Europe. You are in the Middle East. You are in Asia. You are in Africa. You are here in America. You are in the Caribbean. Come on, come on, come on. Jesus is calling you. Jesus is calling you. Repent right now. Accept him as your Lord and Savior. The Lord Jesus will forgive you. Can we pray tonight? Can you say, dear Lord Jesus, I come before you, Lord. I'm begging you, Lord. Remember me. Remember me, Lord. Remember me. Pardon me, oh God. Forgive me for all my sins. Lord, I'm a sinner. I've done a lot of things that I ought not to be doing. I repent, oh Lord. Remember me like you remember the thief, oh God. Lord, I repent. I confess you as my Lord. Come into my heart, Jesus Christ. I believe you are my Savior. You died for me. On the third day, you rose from the dead. Jesus Christ of Nazareth, write my name in the Lamb's Book of Life. Holy Ghost, seal me with your seal in the name of Jesus. Dear Lord Jesus, I covenant my spirit. I covenant my soul. I covenant my body with you, Lord. Forgive me, oh God. Oh, lift up your hands and thank the Lord for your salvation. Thank the Lord for your salvation. He loves you tonight. Lord, help that man, oh Lord, help that woman, oh God, help that family, help that church, oh God, have mercy, oh God, as they've accepted you, oh God, forgive them, oh Lord, wash them with your blood, cleanse them with your blood. For this reason, the Son of Man came to destroy the works of the enemy. Lord, you came that we may have life and that we may have it more abundantly. You came to set the captive free. Lord, you came, oh God Almighty, to open the eyes of the blind. Lord, you came to give us abundant life. I pray that it is granted unto everyone under the sound of my voice in the name of Jesus. Thank you for your people. Thank you for your word. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for your power. Thank you for your anointing. Thank you for your favor. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for salvation in the name of Jesus. Maybe you are watching, you are a believer, you are backslided, or you slow down with your consecration, or you have some things against God, like these other people that have things against Jesus, and they were saying, save yourself and save us. I want you to pray with me right now. Say, dear Lord Jesus, I come before you. I repent of all that I've been thinking, all my mindset that contradicts your word, my desire that is against you. Father Lord, there is grievances in my heart. I am bitter because of what happened to me. I am bitter because of what I found myself in doing. I am angry because of my hope that was disappointed. But Lord, I am sorry. Lord, I'm coming to you. Have mercy upon me. Forgive me, Lord Jesus. Lift up your voice and pray. Pray for yourself right now. I still see blood. I see blood all over. I see blood all over. Yes, I see blood dropping. I see blood dropping. Ye maramanusia mabrete ilo. Habakela kushia madem. Everywhere you find yourself, I see the blood of Jesus is dropping on your life. The blood of Jesus is dropping into your family. The blood of Jesus is dropping for your salvation. The blood of Jesus is dropping for your redemption. The blood of Jesus is dropping for your sanctification. The blood of Jesus is dropping for your justification. Receive the blood. Receive the blood. Receive the blood for your healing, for your deliverance, for restoration. Zampa silokosia, zembelegele kanto henerebe suarande, vranvete mujabata yela, zekito kabarantelem, lambrentela telem, jembrika usa barale, lembrodo yoko yamane, shouete, 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 lembrebelege sutayagata, ijada hazokoto, ijala kahuka bar. Membre lebado salade illa mitu sia la mande gesù lembara la de de meso toi ike cabraboia membre badoia membre badoia e le gende le besu barrante membre ben vosso bi sopra bodo hi e camma la basi sopra bodi sopra bodia ma bende le besu brada o sheli katamara ma membre de le dos endere bossam. Elegetus, Lige de Gas Catala, Father, cleanse us, so God. Purify and make us worthy. Worthy in your presence. Worthy according to your word. Worthy according to your grace. Worthy according to your mercy. Father, somehow we accuse you. Sometimes we condemn. Sometimes our hearts are not right. What we do not know is that you are working on our behalf. What we do not know is that you are working for our favor. What we do not know is that you are doing it for our good. You are doing it for our good. Jesus, we come before you. Pela do shili, pela na suvarana mie. The songwriter says, all things working for my good is intentional. Is intentional. God is doing it intentionally. It's for your good. Did you lost your job? It's for your good. Did you lose a home? It's for your good. Or you lost some amount of money? It's for your good. God will never allow you to fail. God will never disappoint you. God will never do wrong. We give you glory, Lord, as we honor you. We give you glory, Lord, as we honor you. You are wonderful. You are worthy, oh God. You are wonderful. You are worthy, oh God. We give you glory, Lord, as we honor you. We give you glory, Lord, as we honor you. You are wonderful. You are worthy, oh Lord God. You are wonderful. You are worthy, oh God. You are The Bible says the ways of God are not the ways of man. The Bible says as high as the heavens from the earth, so are his ways above our ways. And stop accusing God. Don't misunderstand God. Let him be, let him be, let him be. Let his will be done. Shall we just surrender tonight as we close? Say, thy will be done, O God. Thy will be done, O God. Thy will be done, Holy Ghost. Thy will be done, our Redeemer. Thy will be done, dear Lord Jesus. Thy will be done. Father, we're not going to be responding to the wrong people, the wrong crowd. Lord God, you did not respond to the guy on the left-hand side. Enable us to respond to the right people, the right crowd, for the right purpose. In the name of Jesus, oh, we worship you. Thank you, Lord, for tonight. Thank you for your word. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your presence and your power. Oh, Shambre de Musiara. Yes, there's still room at the cross for you. Though millions have come, there is still room for some. There is this room at the cross for you. Yes, as you continue in the mode of praying, continue to give God glory. Give him all the honor. Give him all the praise. Thank you, Father. We pray for those who are sick right now. Wheresoever they are, I pray for your healing virtue. From the crown of their head to the sole of their feet. Heal them completely in Jesus' name. Every sickness from the crown of your head to the sole of your feet. It doesn't matter where it is or what it is. Incurable terminal diseases and sicknesses. I command you be healed through the blood of Jesus that is prevailing right now. Be healed in Jesus' name. Blind eyes open. Cancer disappear. Deaf ears open. Dumb speak right now. Paralysis disappear. Stroke disappear. Arthritis disappear. Kidney failure. Liver problem disappear in the name of the Lord Jesus. Whatever sickness in the bones, in the muscles, the leg, the kidney, oh, in the name of Jesus, be healed right now. Every sickness within your system, your organs, the respiratory system, the digestive system, your organs, camprodiba shanderebesia, letushe kapan, pambrondo yokotike palasha. Elisa Bruta Yeni Vande Lembri Balokota Kaya Bari and Dose. Be healed in the name of the Lord Jesus. Be delivered now. Be restored completely in Jesus' name. Every demonic yoke, chain, sicknesses and diseases caused by the powers and the forces of darkness be destroyed in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Holy Spirit of the living God. We bless your name. We lift your name higher. 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 We lift your name higher, higher. We lift your name. One more time. Oh, we lift your name higher. We lift your name higher. Lord, we lift your name higher. We lift your name. Thank you, Spirit of the living God. Thank you for healing your people. Thank you for restoring your people. Thank you for healing their heart condition. Lord, grant unto them the grace, Lord, to do ministry in their lives, in their churches, in their family, in their places of work, in their character. Lord, according to your word, according to your will, in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Spirit of the living God. Blessed be your name. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen, beloved. God richly bless you. We thank you so much for your time and your patience. God bless you. To God be the glory for tonight. We want you to kindly share our messages to your loved ones, family members, friends, so that they will get saved, they will get to know the Lord better, and they will be blessed. And don't forget to subscribe. Please keep us in your prayers as we do the same for you. And we hope you join us on Friday for another session of praying. Praise God. God richly bless you. We love you. God bless you. Till we meet again. See you on Friday at 7, Toronto, Canada time. God bless you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.